just in case you're not familiar with it, Enough is Enough. It started back in 2013 when a man named Benny Ware was arrested and thrown from his wheelchair and beaten and maced by the police just because he was waiting for a bus. And so Enough is Enough formed around that incident and started doing actions. And since then, it's grown to do court support for people. We try to get a, you know, contact people when they've been brutalized or harassed by the police, and you know, support them in any way we can. Go to court. We've actually helped with some investigations, and done some Know Your Rights trainings. We work with the Coalition for Police Reform, although we're more towards the left side of reform, meaning abolition of police would be great. But we work with the Coalition for Police Reform, and we've done actions with the black group, black leadership, and community building. Knowledge. Black
building
leadership and community knowledge. And our most recent project that, other than helping these young men right here and bringing them into our fold, we're working, as Catherine mentioned, to try to repeal, we're going to repeal 50A, which is the law that protects the police from having to reveal anything about anything that might affect them in any significant way so that they could be brought to justice. This is Jason Ware. He moved to Chicago 3.5 years ago when he went to DePaul University, from which he graduated in June. He has been involved ever since he went there in various nonprofits with youth organizing and working. He's also a spoken word person. Connoisseur, he teaches spoken word, he does spoken word, and he's worked with various youth groups. Currently he's working for a group called Alternatives, and his job is to do restorative justice in the Frederick Douglass High School in Austin, which is in Chicago. He's been doing that for
almost a year,
and he is here tonight because he's in the group called We Charge Genocide, which I'll let him tell you about, and also the Black Youth 100 Project. And his very significant other is also with my daughter in Asada's Daughters, which is a group that started, a group of young black women supporting black-identified women and girls, and working with them to develop their leadership skills. So, without further ado, Jason Ware, and I'm going to do something with the computer.
You can be my clicker, Mom.
I'll be your clicker. All
right, so we're good on this slide for now. You can keep it. So, hi, everybody. I think I'm going to speak for hopefully half an hour. If I can, I'm long-winded sometimes. But I'm going to speak a little bit about We Charge Genocide and how it started. Black Youth Project 100 and how it started, and then talk about some of the campaigns we worked on in Chicago, and then get into sort of the framework around the framework with which we organize in Chicago, and thinking about youth organizing, what that means, and abolitionist organizing in this time, what that means. And so the first thing I wanted to start off with, though, is if you could click the next slide, Mom.
Which button do I?
Just press the space bar. It should work. Is some of the families that we've worked with and some of the victims that we've worked around. I know that a lot of the work that's being done in Rochester is really, really has a lot of integrity around supporting those who are brutalized by the police and supporting the families of those who are killed by police, right? And I think that like to start off with that great work, not using that to co-opt anything, not using that to get any claim to fame or anything, but actually doing that work because it matters, is really important. And that's I just included these pictures just now because I remembered that bringing the victims and those who have died in Chicago and talking about their stories in Rochester is really important. because these deaths happen all over the country. And so some of the four main young black people who have died in Chicago by police violence that we've worked around are Rekia Boyd. Her picture's in the top left corner. She was killed by Officer Dante Servin in 2011, 2012. She was at a barbecue with her friends on the west side of Chicago, and off-duty police officer Dante Servin shot into a crowd when he was mad at them for being too loud or having alcohol or whatever it was, and killed her. On the top right, there's a picture of a march that was organized by We Charge Genocide for a boy named Stefan Watts. Stefan Watts was a 13, 14-year-old boy who was had some mental health concerns, and he was his father called the police just to get him to go to school one day, and he was also having like a manic episode, and he was just needed to be calmed down. Police came in the house and shot him on sight because he was holding a knife, but he was also in the corner of this kitchen and not charging anybody, a young boy killed by police. Ronnie Johnson and LaQuan McDonald were killed, I believe, in 2014. And a year ago, around October, killed 8 weeks apart from each other. Everybody, I think, is familiar with LaQuan McDonald's case because the video of his death just came out, which sparked a lot of protests in Chicago. Ronnie Johnson's death also has sparked a lot of protests lately, and his dash cam was released because of LaQuan McDonald's. And right now, Dorothy Holmes, Ronald Johnson's mom, is doing a lot of great work. She organized a food, a toy drive for the community. Even though she doesn't have her son, she organized a toy drive for other people with sons and daughters in Chicago, which is really great. And she's been on the front lines every single week doing things. It's been really great to see the work that's been done around these deaths and lifting their lives up. And that's a lot of the work that We Charge Genocide, Black Lives Matter Chicago, and We Charge Genocide, and Black Project 100. These are the families and the folks that we've really been supporting since we've been active. So next, I want to talk a little bit about We Charge Genocide and how it started. And so I'll just say, first of all, We Charge Genocide is probably the greatest thing that ever happened in my life. It trained me, it molded me, it really just changed my entire life. And in thinking about like organizing that happens around this country, it's unthinkable to think that in 6 months, We Charge Genocide did what people do in years. We Charge Genocide is really great. And it was started by a group of young people and a mentor of ours and theirs named Mariam Kaba, Mariam Kaba is a prison and police abolitionist who does a lot of restorative justice, transformative justice work and youth organizing work. And she knew and had trained some youth organizers named Ethan Van Leer, Paige May, and others who knew this young man named Dominic Franklin. My friend Ethan, who helped start We Charge Genocide, knew a young man named Damo who was killed in April of 2014. He went into a coma after being tased by the police because he was suspected of stealing a bottle of liquor. And after Damo's death, a lot of people got together in Chicago and didn't really know what to do. This was a death that hit a lot of organizers close to home, and they'd been doing a lot of work, but they were like, we need something new, we need to do something else. And so We Charge Genocide started because of his death. We Charge Genocide became a coalition of activists from across the city, from police abolitionists to just grassroots organizers to people from Chicago Votes, which is an electoral politics organization. So a lot of people got together and were like, okay, what are we going to do about this? And so you can skip to the next slide. And so what they did was, they were like, what we're going to do is we're going to create a petition to the UN Committee Against Torture to not only get Damo's death in the limelight and like get it known and bring some justice to Chicago, but to talk about the the plethora of things that go in Chicago that the police do, and charge the Chicago Police Department, which is the second largest police department in the country, but the deadliest police department in the country, charge them with genocide of black communities and young people of color, and charge them with torture, that they have broken human rights codes that are internationally based, and bring that to the forefront. And so Paige May did a lot of this work of finding the data to make this report that they eventually gave to the UN. And some of the data that they got, what they found was that, for one, between 2009 and 2013, 75% of police shooting victims were black. Even though black people only make up 32% of Chicago's entire population. Another finding, and there's a whole bunch of findings in the report to the UN, but between 2002 and 2004, out of the 10,000 complaints against CPD, only 124 of those were sustained. Reading my mom's report of RPD, it's the same. It's basically the same number when you get down to percentages of. But it's the number of complaints is ridiculous. 10,000 complaints in one city. That's ridiculous. If you can click on the hyperlink up there, Mom, this is the on We Charge Genocide's website. You can go and look at the entire report that they made to the UN. And I just want to say, you can stay right here, Mom. What I want to say is that this report. The idea for this thing called We Charge Genocide, this grassroots collective, this idea of going to the UN, came from a 1951 petition, the original We Charge Genocide petition, which William Patterson wrote. William Patterson was a really important black communist in the 1940s and 50s. Did a lot. He was a lawyer who did a lot of great work with the Scottsboro Boys case. Did a lot of work throughout the 50s to 70s, training some of the Black Panthers and his organizing. And so we take our legacy from this petition when the NAACP was way too far neutral to take things to the next level and wasn't being radical enough. William Patterson broke from that sort of regime of the 1960s, 1950s and like style organizing and went to the UN with actually Paul Robeson, if anybody knows Paul Robeson, the artist, and created and gave this petition. And the famous quote from that is, "The classic method of lynching was the rope, and now is the policeman's bullet." And that quote in and of itself is what sparked the youth organizers in April of last year now to do this. So you can go back to that PowerPoint now. So we stand on really, really big shoulders and a lot of history. And then next slide. So my friends, they go to the UN. This is them in front of, in Geneva, in front of the UN after they had testified.
Geneva, Switzerland, right?
Yeah. Also, We Charge Genocide raised $20,000 to go on this trip in a month. Just through like crowdfunding and things. Some of the best minds of organizing came together to make this happen. I don't know. I wasn't around during that time. I was just doing social media stuff. Because I came out in August. They had already started raising money then. So it was really great. And so they go to the UN. They give this petition. They get a whole bunch of media coverage. Go on MSNBC at least once every week during the cycle of that time. Because they went October something. And when they get back, they have this great report back. Everyone from Chicago is riled up. They're like, oh, this is great work. But there was still work to be done in Chicago after we made this report, found all these findings. And it really was a time when we had the political machine on its heels because they're getting all this bad press. It was a different time. And so after we came back, we were doing a lot of Shy Cop Watch, which was I know Mom talked a little bit about doing like Know Your Rights workshops. We did Know Your Rights workshops all across Chicago in different schools. We also did like Cop Watch workshops specifically. So we're trying to what I was really involved in when I started was going out to like a youth program I worked at before and training eighth graders to not only know how to deal with police but how to document and document misconducts when they happen, and we did this all through social media. So if you had a smartphone, you could take a video of the police doing harassing people or doing whatever they were doing. And if you hashtag Shy Cop Watch, it will go straight to our Twitter feed. And then we also, on our Twitter feed, we had a link to a report line where you could go on and right there, really quick, report what's going on with the police. And we used that data to create more reports, find more statistics. And it was a really fast way to get young people, not just, you know, the older generation who use a lot of paper. We were trying to figure out how to get young people to document the things that are happening to them. And we used Twitter and Facebook to do that. And so that was one of the first thing I was really involved in with getting a lot of people trained. And then around December was when we really broke off into the torture reparations campaign. So that was with a long-standing campaign to get John Burge, who was a commander of the Chicago Police Department in the 1970s, I believe. He tortured over 119 Black and Latino men. And was never found guilty of it. He was found guilty of lying about it and went to jail for about 4 years for that, but still has a pension by the Chicago Police Department. He's paid, he lives in Florida, he's on vacation, living a great life. But he tortured men. I mean, he shocked them with electrical equipment. He suffocated them with bags. He did all types of things. And finally, with the work of like We Charge Genocide, Black Youth Project 100, and different organizations who came together to help the families who've been fighting for this for a long time, we got a $5 million reparation settlement for these victims. Not only did they get money to accommodate them, but also got free medical treatment for them, mental health services, education, and they were set to make a memorial for the torture reparations campaign so that it could be taught in CPS schools and so that it would be something that was never lost, which was really great that we got that passed. After that campaign came, still doing the Shy Cop Watch work, but then we started working on the Radical Education Project, which was the spark of a lot of great work, actually. So the Radical Education Project was taking young people and bringing them into a space where they could talk to organizers and talk to artists and learn how to use art as activism. How do you make a banner? How do you make shirts? How do you make signs? How do you make all these things in a way that can be used in direct action so that you make your voices heard and use some of your skills in a different way? And so we had about four or five of these workshops over the course of the year. The last one was organized by my partner and some of our friends, which was strictly focused on like the legacy of Emery Douglas and some of the artwork of the Black radicals in the 70s and how that was used. And so that was a lot of good education campaigns for young people to get involved. Then we had something called the Shy Stops campaign, which is a really great campaign that's still going on, where young people from across the city got together from high schools. We recruited young people from high schools and asked them, like, do you want to work on something against police violence? And they were like, yeah. And what we worked on was we're trying to bring advocacy towards the stop and frisk that are going on in Chicago. So stop and frisk is when you think about New York City, it's really a big topic and that's what comes to mind. But actually, stop and frisk is worse in Chicago than it is anywhere else. There's more stop and frisk in Chicago than anywhere else. But it's not documented in a way that you're able to bring claims against the city and against the Chicago Police Department to hold them accountable. So the Shy Stops Project was getting young people to advocate for getting information about stop and frisk and passing the Stop Act, which would allow us to get information about stop and frisk, because CPD doesn't track who and how they arrest people and how they interact with people. And so we got young people to start this campaign and almost got the Stop Act passed, actually, and through the city council in a very short amount of time. I think 3 months they worked on it and got it introduced to the city council, which which was really great, but then got co-opted by the ACLU of Chicago, which is, ACLU, I can explain a lot more later. Basically, they're an organization of lawyers and legal advocates that basically took what the Stop Act was, watered it down, and got it passed a lot quicker. And so our organizing for that was kind of cut short. But regardless, it was once again young people of color, young black people getting involved and doing something very, very fast with a lot of resources, which is really, really good. And then I won't talk as much about countercaps because it's not as interesting, but because what I'll say about that is that Chicago has something called called CAPS, which is the community policing wing of Chicago Police, which is to build community relations and things like that. It's really all bullshit. And so what we did was we did a campaign where we talked about the community policing in Chicago and how it's actually being used to build more police power and not more community power. So we created a report around that. The last thing I'll talk about for We Charge Genocide specifically is the Dyett Hunger Strike. So Dyett High School was a school that was being phased out as a high school. It was being closed for budgetary reasons. CPS is cutting a lot of funding, a lot of schools. Rahm Emanuel, the mayor, has closed over 50 schools in Chicago. Dyett High School is one of them. And the community have been fighting to keep it open for a very long time, for about 4 years at this point. In this September, it was being the decision was going to be made about if it was going to stay open or not, and if it was going to stay open, what type of school would it be? Would it be a private school, a charter school? What was it going to be? And so the Dyett Hunger Strikers, which were a combination of an organization called COCO, the Kenwood Oakland Community Organization, Teaching for Social Justice, and other groups came together to create this hunger strike, get national media attention about Dyett staying open, and We Charge Genocide poured out, and BYP100 poured out a lot of support to do a lot of social media for them, make sure that they were getting press coverage, help co-organize marches with them. We shut down public hearings with Rahm Emanuel with them. The Dyett Hunger Strikers went to talk to Rahm Emanuel at public hearings, and we shut a meeting down and took the mic from Rahm Emanuel. It was just beautiful things we did with the Dyett Hunger Strikers. It was really, really beautiful. And through backdoor sort of political games, Rahm Emanuel gave Dyett High School to the community, made it a public high school, not a private or charter, which was what we wanted, but they did not take the proposal that the community created and instead decided to just make it a normal high school with art-based programs, but didn't take the proposal that was created. It was a beautiful proposal that people from the Kenwood Oakland Community Organization created to make a green technology high school. Now, mind you, at this time, Rahm Emanuel has poured in millions of dollars to make Chicago one of the greenest cities in the world. And so there's tons of money for like green technology, green transformation for the city. The Dyett High School has a greenhouse on campus, and it's on one of the biggest, it's on the biggest parks in Chicago, Washington Park. So all of these things make sense to have a green technology high school. Rahm Emanuel just basically said, F you, we're not gonna open that high school even though it makes sense for the for the community. We're gonna make an arts program high school. And so that's kind of how that went. So you can go next. So that's all of the campaigns I think that We Charge Genocide has had. Now I'll talk a little bit about Black Youth Project 100. Did we skip a slide?
I don't know. How do I go back?
The back arrow. There we go. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about Black Youth Project 100. Where am I at on time?
Okay.
So BYP 100 is an organization that also started in Chicago, because Chicago is the city for Black Youth organizing, I believe. It started because a woman named Kathy Cohen, who started a nonprofit organization based out of the University of Chicago called Black Youth Project, and she brought together 100 organizers, leaders around the country of young black leaders to just talk about policy agendas, skill sharing, just sort of like, it really wasn't meant to create an organization. But at the time of the conference that these 100 leaders were together sharing stories, sharing skills, that was when the George Zimmerman verdict came out. And so I think the second day of the conference was the day that the George Zimmerman verdict came out, and 100 black young people were in the room together grieving this. And out of that, we had marches, but people were hyped and were like, okay, we need to go out and do something else. Like, what we're doing right now is not enough. And a lot of people felt that in their hearts. I think a lot of people in this room are here. I know my mom is here because of the Trayvon Martin case. And so at the time, people came together and were like, okay, we're gonna create an organization that's national that can address this. That's around the same time that the Dream Defenders started in Florida to fight for Trayvon Martin. And they created the base that they're gonna create an organization that was 18 to 35 because the people who needed to be organized around this issue were black, young black people 18 to 35. I'll leave that aside. But in a month later in DC, when there was the 50th anniversary of the March on Washington, or the 60th anniversary of the March on Washington, can't remember which. That was when a lot of the leaders came back together to work and create what is now BYP100. So if it wasn't for those two things happening together, you wouldn't have the strength and the nationally focused organization that we have. We have chapters in DC, Detroit, Chicago, New Orleans, the Bay Area, Oakland, San Francisco, and we're creating one in North Carolina very soon. And so I'll go next. I'll talk a little bit about the campaigns that Black Youth Project 100 has done, specifically in Chicago. And I left out BYP100 has a chapter in New York City as well. Forgot to say that. So the first campaign that BYP100 worked on was the Decriminalize Black campaign, which talks about, similar to Stop and Frisk, the Stop and Frisk work, talking about how when black youth are stopped and frisked, they're stopped and frisked for petty marijuana arrests. And so a lot of the arrests that happen in Chicago and a lot of the money that is extracted from the black community in Chicago to the courts and to the police is from this criminalization of marijuana, which is ridiculous. And so the first campaign we had was to decriminalize and bring attention to, to bring attention to the fact that, 70, I'm not gonna know the numbers because I didn't work on this campaign, but that it's like a 10-to-1 ratio for arrests for marijuana between the black and the white community, right? Even though the usage rates for the white community is higher than the community for black folks, which is really interesting. And that's nationally too. The drug use across the country is higher in white communities than black communities in general, but black communities are mass incarcerated for that. So bringing attention to that and doing the work to decriminalize marijuana make sure that you don't get arrested and taken to jail for having marijuana, but that you get a ticket that's no less than $50. That's no more than $50. And that's sort of the work that we've been trying to push. We've been trying to push that policy through the state legislature. BYP has always been really involved in economic justice work and in livable wage work. And so they've partnered with the Fight for 15 campaign since they started, doing a lot of work in New York City, where they did win the $15 minimum wage. BYP100 was on the streets a lot for that. And so we've done countless actions with Fight for 15 around livable wage work, really supporting folks, especially because black women have the highest rates of being in low wage work, like working at McDonald's or whatever those jobs are, and having to sustain the community right now. Single mothers who are women of color are the ones who are really affected by these low wage jobs, right? And so that's really where a lot of our work comes from, and to tie that in specifically to the Say Her Name campaign. Say Her Name is like a national sort of campaign it started around, it got a lot of force around the Rekia Boyd case. But Say Her Name is about, talking about the state violence and the violence in general against black women. And whether that's economic, whether it's through just economic injustice in general, housing rights, police killings, whatever it is, or childcare. There's a lot of things that are taken away from the black community that specifically affect black women. And so the Say Her Name campaign is not just about getting justice for the black women who are killed, but talking about how do, when we talk about Black Lives Matter, how do black trans women, black and black women, black cis women, like fit into that, right? And so one of the main wins that have come from that campaign are, we've got the officer who killed Rekia Boyd. He's been set to be fired by the Chicago Police Department. And this picture right here is a picture of one of the actions that got that to happen. This is Ethan, Damo's friend, actually. My friend Christina and me. This is in one of the police board hearings that we went to advocate to the police board and to McCarthy, the superintendent of police, that they fire Officer Dante Servin. And through this was not the time we took over the meeting, but one of the many times we went in there and disrupted it. But in September, we took over the entire meeting, took the mic, shut down the entire meeting from happening, very close to getting arrested, but got out of there. And from shutting down that police meeting, that was when IPRA, which is basically, so it's sort of similar to the PSS here, that you guys have, where like you have the state body that is supposed to be separate from the police, but isn't really separate from the police, that looks at police killings and doesn't do anything about it, or police brutality. We were at that body, IPRA, and they recommended, I think a week after that, okay, Dante Severin should be fired. Stop disrupting our meetings. And then I think it wasn't until the LaQuan McDonald verdict came out that they were gonna release the dash cam and that the Jason Van Dyke, the one who killed LaQuan McDonald, should be arrested. That was when McCarthy came out and said, okay, Dante Severin should be fired. And then it wasn't long after that, after we did the action for LaQuan McDonald, it shut down the streets of Chicago for 2-3 days. That was when finally they came out and Rahm Emanuel fired the superintendent McCarthy. So there's been a lot of great trajectory from the work that Black Youth Project 100 has been doing in Chicago, and just disrupting and taking things over to make sure that people are held accountable.
So, 10 minutes.
Huh?
10 minutes.
10 minutes. Cool. That's perfect. So the last thing I was going to talk about was the coolest. This is where I kind of shift into talking about like, what does an abolitionist politic look like? What does it really mean? And for young black people to be at the forefront of like an abolitionist framework. And so on the left, you have a picture of a campaign that We Charge Genocide was a part of that was around talking about the budget, the Chicago police budget and the city budget that just got passed in Chicago. And on the right is a picture of an action that we did in October 24th, where we shut down a chief of police hearing, a chief of police convening. So I'll talk a little bit about both of those things. But these actions both fall under the guise of funding black futures, which is what I have on my shirt. And so we believe in We Charge Genocide and Black Youth Project 100 that we need to defund police now and reinvest in community development projects, education, things of that nature, mental health facilities, childcare, and one way to do that, there's two ways to do that, to make that happen, from the direct action side. One is you can go to the city board hearing, which is what we did, what We Charge Genocide. When the city budget was being passed by Rahm Emanuel, we went there and had this action where we showed visually how the budget breaks down in terms of, you know, the fire department, travel, finance expenses, and then this is the police budget. So in Chicago, 40% of the city budget is spent on police, and I'm very certain that it's the same in Rochester. So of all the things that we spend money on in Chicago, 40% of that is spent on police. $4 million a day we spend on police. And so what We Start Genocide did was we did a slew of actions and media campaigns to try to push the city to spend less money on the police and cap the budget for the police. I mean, we can't get them to defund it totally, but to stop spending more money on police every year. It didn't work yet, but that's gonna be an ongoing campaign every year, is trying to get the city council and the mayor to agree to cut the city budget. So that's one way to go about this. The other way to go about this is to get 66 of your best friends and to get in the street and shut down a conference for 5 hours. So what we did was we spent a month creating chains and boxes and getting my this is my partner up here on a ladder. And we chained ourselves to each other, locked ourselves to each other, and got in the middle of the street around the convening space where there would be 15,000 police chiefs and police officers coming in for a conference to talk about how to kill people better, basically. And so we surrounded all the streets and the entrances to the buildings in civil disobedience. We all got arrested after shutting it down, but we locked it down for a long, long time, stopped traffic completely, a whole bunch of things. And this is a picture of one of the groups, because we had five different groups who got together to do this. Most of them were on the outside. One group was inside, locked to the skyway, where you walked from the hotel into the conference. So anyone who stayed in the hotel couldn't just walk from their hotel into the conference. They were blocked by us. So this was one of the groups that was on Michigan Avenue in Chicago. This is actually one of the buses that was carrying people to the conference. They had to stop here and walk all the way up there just to get to where they wanted to go. This is, once again, this is my partner. I'm just so proud of
her. What's her name? Her.
Kyra, she's a great artist, great activist, helped found the organization my sister's in called Asada's Daughters. And she's up on a ladder here holding the liberation flag. These are people locked to each other with lock boxes, laying down in the street so that no one can get by. And this is Paige May, the mastermind who also wrote the UN report, basically led Recharge Genocide and helped found Asada's Daughters. And so that's the work that we did to really take it to the police and tell them, we're not gonna fund you, we don't believe in you, we want you to leave. And the mayor definitely heard that, because soon after that was when he fired Superintendent McCarthy. And so I think that's the last one. So the last thing I wanted to do was just talk about the specific demands that were for that action for Fund Black Futures. BYP100's demands are investing dollars and resources into Black Futures by taking budgets away from state and federal police, giving reparations for chattel slavery, Jim Crow, and mass incarceration, ending profit from punishment, so taking away private prisons and the money that's spent on that. Guaranteed income, so job programs by the federal level and a living wage. Making sure that all labor, even the labor that's not necessarily labor for survival, so sex work, other types of survival that usually trans and gender nonconforming people have to engage in the Black community, making sure that those jobs are valued. And then investments in economic sustainability and really fighting for this, to me, is just fighting gentrification and making sure that our communities are protected. So that's abolitionist organizing in a nutshell. I think that's the last slide. Yeah. So that was a lot. Thank y'all for listening to my stories and stuff. So yeah, now we can just talk. Any questions about the campaigns I mentioned or questions around like how to get involved in some of this stuff? I don't think I talked a lot about how to support and how to get involved.
Yeah, I'd definitely like to know how to get involved and be a part of what's going on.
Can you speak up?
So how to get involved, right? Like what are more ways to support? So Black Youth Project 100 is a nonprofit organization. And if you ever want to raise money for Black Youth Project 100, we could always use it because things like this come from that, and like creating actions together. It costs like more than $5,000 to make that action happen, because we had to get trained. We had to bring in and fly people from across from New York City and DC to come from Black Youth Project 100 to do that action. So like there's a lot of fundraising involved in Black Youth Project 100. But to join, as long as you're 18 to 35 or know people who are 18 to 35, you can email the director, Charlene Carruthers, to think about starting up a chapter. Chapters are starting up all over. I think, just in my opinion, I think that Black, which is started at a University of Rochester, I believe, students there, I met a lot of them and they're really dope.
Maybe we're just here if you
might. Oh really?
Yeah.
like partnering with those folks and maybe creating a like Black Youth Project 100 chapter could probably happen through like the connections of folks here. Following on Twitter and Facebook, so like the Twitter handle for BYP100 is at BYP_100. So like keeping up to date with the stuff we're doing that way.
Excellent, thank you.
Yeah.
What is the atmosphere like in Chicago right now with the two recent murders by the police and LaQuan and like it just sounds it seems like it's a I don't know it just seems like unbelievable.
Yeah, it's sort of disorganized at this point. I mean, there's a lot of things happening all over the city where things weren't happening before, where it would take us to call an action before, We Charge Genocide or BYP or Black Lives Matter. Now folks from the community are just haphazardly just going to vigils or shutting things down or whatever it is. So it's hard to keep tabs on everything, which is a good thing, but also it's kind of scary right now in Chicago because there's a lot of people who are connected to the political machine in Chicago who are sort of co-opting the stuff that's going on. So for example, after the LaQuan McDonald shooting, we had two actions, and on Black Friday, Jesse Jackson came out with his whole crew and was coming out talking about the things he wanted and things he was doing in the community. When since Damo died, and this organizing picked up in Chicago, he has not done a thing, nothing. He helped support the Dyett hunger strikers. On face value, he opened up his office to the Dyett hunger strikers, but Jesse Jackson hasn't done any on-the-ground mobilization work, getting the community involved at all with any of this. So he comes out on Black Friday to do that. So a lot of this, like getting the media attention and the press coverage, because Chicago is like the epicenter of a lot of this work right now and the media coverage of it. So that's a little scary for me, at least, to think about. But the thing you spoke on was there were two people who were just killed on Saturday by Chicago police. One of them was in, Benny Jones and Quintonio, what's his last, Greer? LeGreer, were killed. Benny was actually a mother, she was 47 years old, and she was a member of a grassroots organization called Action Now. Action Now has worked with Fight for 15, they've been on the ground with us, shutting things down at Rahm Emanuel's office. They advocate, when we were doing the Dyett hunger strike, Action Now folks were working with that. So it's really disheartening that she was killed by the Chicago police on Saturday. Didn't do anything but open the door to her house, and the police shot and killed her. She literally did nothing else but open the door. And so that's really crazy right now too. I'm not there, so I don't know all the things that are going on, but I know BYP has made contact with the family. We Charge Genocide has made contact with the family. They're working with them. They've been at some of the vigils for them really fast. Things that are happening. People are just even more pissed because you just have LaQuan McDonald's video come, and now you have two people being killed. And one of them was, Quintonio was, I think, a sophomore or a freshman at Northern Illinois University. He was 20 years old, coming home for Christmas like I was, and just got killed. So it was really, really disheartening. So, you and me.
I'm just curious, Jason, do you have any sense of what it will take or will take to bring Rahm Emanuel down?
I think it can be done. I've never seen it done before. And a lot of people, like, we've been asking ourselves this question, like, what does it take to get a mayor out of Chicago? And I think we've been doing a lot of the steps to make sure that he is on his heels, because he fired McCarthy. His right hand kind of person for this police violence stuff is Anita Alvarez, who's the state's attorney, and she's on her way out. So if she doesn't get elected, because she's the one who like didn't try Dante Servant, she's the one who didn't try Ronnie Mann's killer. She's the one who's really holding up her side of what Rahm Emanuel wants done. And if she's gone, and we help elect someone else, the state's attorney, and there is someone running against her who we're sort of supporting. We're in contact with her. I know people from her campaign. Her name is Kim Fox. She's running against the state's attorney. She's much more on the left. So if Anita Alvarez is out of office, then Ron really has nobody on his side, no allies at all. And I think he's also shown his weaknesses by giving, one of the other things that happened in Chicago was a group called Fly, who we're very, very close with, Fearless Leading by Youth. They were trying to get a trauma center for the south side of Chicago in University of Chicago, because University of Chicago is one of the best medicine programs in the world, really. It's right down the street from one of the communities that has the most police, a lot of police violence, but also a lot of shootings, which is Woodlawn. And they, Fearless Leading by Youth, fought to have a trauma center put into the University of Chicago for about 3 years or 4 years, and finally got it won, two weeks ago. So that also comes out of nowhere, and comes because Ron made a phone call to say, all right, give these young black people what they're fighting for. Because the leaders are Fearless Leading by the Youth, we've been partnering with forever. So they know that we're all the same, mm-hmm. and they know that we work with each other. And so that shows that they're willing to, Rahm Emanuel is willing to give things up. And once we win everything that we want, once we put pressure enough, and he has no other stops, and Anita Alvarez is gone, I think we can push him out of office. But he has no other stops to really get good media coverage. And this killing doesn't look good for him either.
So I guess I just was noticing as you were talking about trying to move money out of the police and into more social service education, whatever, that in the larger picture in the United States, it's like trying to move money out of the Pentagon.
Right.
And into the education and health related programs.
Right.
That need it. So that's interesting, I think.
Yeah, I mean, it's the same system, right?
It's the same
police
system.
Militarization in the military.
Yeah.
It's really the same system, and it's just as hard. Like, it would take a lot of work to get money from the army and fund education, right? Like, people have been fighting for that forever, and it's never happened.
Right.
So it's that hard to do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you have a lot of white supporters, and what is their role in all of this?
That's a great question. So We Charge Genocide was largely supported by folks who are leaders in white organizations. And so a lot of the support has been, you know, helping young people of color with learning how to do things like the Cop Watch workshops and the Know Your Rights workshops. I did those, but I was taught by a lot of white allies and friends, right? And so like that type of work, those skill shares. A lot of the social media stuff, the fundraising, was done by white comrades. Civil disobedience, like specifically in Chicago, there's a culture of trust that like we don't want more people of color being locked up, more black people specifically being locked up. And so if we're gonna do something that puts us at the risk of being arrested, we're gonna call, you know, white folks to be on that role if possible. Because more access to getting out, more connections to lawyers, things like that, right? And so that's been a lot of the roles. Black Youth Project 100 is only black everything. We Charge Genocide is intergenerational and interracial. And I can't speak enough about how the ability, We Charge Genocide is a really great example of like not only white folk, but like elders stepping back and saying, I know some things, I'm gonna let you young people of color like do this. I'm gonna teach you some stuff, but it's not gonna be in a dynamic of like, I know best, but I'm gonna like give you some stuff and help you run with it. And so that's really been the dynamic for Chicago. So, yeah.
Okay. Any other questions?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Will you speak a little bit about, like, you're doing this restorative justice work with kids, and how does that play into the activism? A lot of energy about that in the schools now going on here, and I'd love to figure out how to pull it together.
Yeah, so I can speak on, let's see, exactly what I'm working on now. So I can speak on like historically in Chicago, because Chicago has a great history of like how the RJ work has been influenced by like the activism.
For those who don't know, could you explain restorative justice?
Oh man. That's a whole other conversation. Basically, it's an alternative form of dealing with conflict and punishment. Yeah. So, the easiest way to explain it. So, in Chicago, I'll speak about, like, there's this organization called Community Justice for Youth Institute. Community Justice for Youth Institute. The Chicago Freedom School. Organizations such as those, who also are in relation to Miriam Cabo, who I spoke about, who helped start Recharge Genocide. In the 90s, a lot of the youth organizers, what their work was getting restorative justice into high schools. So in order to decrease the school-to-prison pipeline, right, which, like, suspends students, make sure they have criminal backgrounds and, like, sort of, or like, are seen as deviant and then end up having those behaviors and getting shuffled in the prison system. In the 90s, the work we stand on in BYP100, We Charge Genocide, is that work to get restorative justice, something that's actually tangible, that can be used. And so since then, restorative justice has grown around Chicago. I work for an organization that works in like 10 high schools, where we do work that's in everyday work, we're stopping the school to prison pipeline, trying to. But CPS, let's get some things clear about that though. CPS.
What's CPS?
Chicago Public Schools gets a lot of money from the police department. Spends a lot of money on the police department because they have two full-time officers in every CPS high school to arrest students for. I had a student in my school that was arrested for who was arrested from the peace room in my school where we do restorative justice work, was taken out of the school for writing Facebook comments about the school. She was arrested for assault, right? So this is the things that CPS does, and now she has a record. And so the restorative justice work is trying to get in between, actively get in between in the schools, and try to make sure that the culture of the school is changed from being so punitive to being restorative, and doing things like peace circles, restorative conversations, just teaching mediation tactics that a lot of people should know, and teaching the mentality overall in the school that, like, by suspending somebody, by kicking them out, by arresting them, that you're causing more harm than you actually are creating a good community. So my work is on the west side of Chicago in a high school that's being stripped of resources, might close at the end of the year. Same old story for every school in Chicago and a lot of schools in Rochester, right? And has police officers that keep arresting kids. They've arrested more than 5 students this year. And my job is to every day try to get in between that. But it's very, very difficult. And it's not as easy as I thought it would be in terms of, like, making the impact. It's a very entrenched system of this suspension in this punitive environment.
Can I do the follow-up?
Yeah.
Because that's kind of what we're doing in a few schools here, just what you're talking about. But are you able to bring in your activism into the school?
Right.
Are you able to do that, and if so, how? Because that's the part that I'd really like to understand.
So a lot of what we're trying to do is, like, across the agency is make sure that when we're having circles, circles is a way of having a conversation. It's a way of dialogue, and I could talk about what circles are more in depth. But trying to, like, bring the topic of police violence up in classrooms in a circle environment and have students talk about their experiences and talk about, like, what they want to do about it. But it's also, it's very hard to do right now for a couple reasons. For the capacity of, like, the time that I have with, like, dealing with like fights that are happening or whatever, trying to have conversations about police violence is really hard. But that's some of the work, is like bringing it up in conversation. I did a presentation for the basketball team to talk about LaQuan McDonald. We had like a dialogue, but it was really, really hard. They all did not want to talk about police violence because a lot of what's happening in these schools is like they're a specific, like there's this guy who I work with named Cedric, who is on the basketball team and has lost like 4 or 5 friends to gun violence from gang violence. Mm-hmm. And he's trying to use basketball as a ticket out of the gangs. And so when I'm not worried about the police. I'm worried about going home and being shot and killed by mm-hmm. people who killed my people. Nobody I know has been killed by police. But they don't like police, but they're more afraid of the community. And so we're trying to bridge those divides. And so a lot of the work that I think restorative justice can do is teaching young people that the root, where does the root of trauma comes from? So restorative justice can talk about how you know, trauma creates violence, which creates more trauma, which creates more violence. And so, like, police with guns and brutality and incarceration is trauma that creates violence, that creates more violence. So, like, when we talk about, so I'm trying to, like, bridge that gap and have young people learn that, that actually police and prisons cause more harm to communities,
right,
and suspensions cause more harm to communities, and making that sort of a dual thing. But to be honest, the administration I work for does not like what I'm doing outside of work. They don't talk about it to me, or they make jokes about it. So they try to, like, they know that I do it and they don't appreciate it. And yeah, so it's difficult. When you're working in a school with police officers, it's hard to get them to be against police, especially when one of the police officers is the cheerleading coach. So it's weird. it's weird, but yeah. There's a way to incorporate it. But another thing I'm trying to do is there's been a lot of walkouts in CPS. So like the students in high schools have been walking out, and I just got contacted by a student who wants to do a walkout at a high school in the South Side. And so I connected her with some of the friends I work with in schools in the South Side to try to see if they could connect. But that also is a really close thing, because we can lose our funding and lose our grant if we help students get this information and say, hey, walk out on Thursday to protest Rahm Emanuel. My friend got in trouble for that already. So we're trying to, yeah. I mean, the right thing to do, restorative justice-wise, is to walk out of school and make your voice be heard. Like, that's restorative justice. Like, that's how you get justice. And we're trying to teach that, but we have to be very careful. So, yeah. Yeah.
About some of the nuts and bolts activity that would go on before an action, in terms of training, recruiting new leaders, planning, coordinating, and how you do the coalition work around that.
Okay. So for like for a big action like a civil disobedience, we had to fly in folks from the Blackout Collective, which is a collective of very well-trained organizers who have done civil disobedience before. So they came out and did a two-day retreat with us to teach us how to use lockboxes, how to chain ourselves to things, what are legal ramifications of certain civil disobediences, things around that nature. That took about 2 days to do that work. And then every week we were practicing with each other, figuring out what points we were gonna hit. For an action like that, we had to have people designated as scouts, people designated as people who get arrested, people who are designated as people who would assist and be around the people who were being arrested to make sure they were safe and make sure that they were not brutalized or whatever. Making sure we were talking to the National Lawyers Guild, who will come and scout during an action to make sure that people aren't being roughed up, and who can go to the court and advocate later. So every sort of civil disobedience has that kind of formula. In terms of like our marches and our direct actions and things, we always start with the Facebook page, start with the invitations to make sure like people know about it. And like there'll be a coordinating team on Black Youth Project 100 or Recharge Genocide who specifically are in charge of the communications for that action. And then at actions, you know, we have over time, it hasn't really been like a formal process of getting trained, but over time, by being involved in planning processes and being at actions, people are trained as marshals to help get marches where they need to go. And we have like maybe two for every 50 people, two marshals for every 50 people that are at an action to make sure that people are staying on the path and coordinating. Always have our banners out front, and then one person doing chants at the front of the march. And so those are all things that are designated in the planning processes. We always try to call at least two meetings before we do actions like that, when there's going to be a lot of people. And so the coalition work, we have been blessed with just knowing a lot, just being in network with a lot of people. Like the Dyett Hunger Strike, that was a coalition of community organizations and Teachers for Social Justice, and the Chicago Teachers Union was involved too. And just through like relationships and knowing people, we were able to build those bonds. But I think that coalition building comes from showing up at other people's actions, being at panels with each other and staying connected. And that's really how I think I built a lot of relationships in Chicago.
Yeah.
So. Yes.
You mentioned the ACLU at the beginning. Friend or foe?
Foe, for sure. Yeah, ACLU has not been good. Illinois ACLU has not been good. Like I said, they co-opted that bill, that act that we tried to get through city council, and they've also been in bad relations with Oakland, who is very, they have dope activists. Blackout Collective, I think, started in Oakland. The BYP100 chapter in Oakland hasn't had good relationships with the ACLU. I don't know exactly the specifics, but I know that they just do a lot of, like, after young people have done a lot of work to advocate for an issue, they create something very, very similar and then try to put it in. So, we don't mess with ACLU. And We Charge Genocide came out with an entire open letter around why nobody should work with the ACLU again.
Wow.
And the ACLU responded with an apology. So they knew they were wrong. Mm-hmm. The ACLU, from what I know, is, you know, a nonprofit of legal, legal professionals who try to advocate for things, but in order to keep their funding, they have to win certain things. They have to say, oh yeah, we passed this, we did this. And so that's why they're able to do what they do, because if it's about money and they want to get accolades for something, then they'll push them to do fast, regardless of if it's good for the community or not.
Mm-hmm.
And so just to be clear, when we put in the STOP Act, they created an act that went through city council that what it did was it got the information that we wanted, which basically was when the police stopped somebody, what race were they, what were they stopped for, and what was the interaction. Those are the things that we didn't know, that we didn't have on paper. They got that information, but it's only theirs to release, instead of it being public information, which is what we asked for. So it doesn't do anything. It gets the information documented, but then it can't be FOIA'd, so you can't get it through that legal means. You have to ask ACLU for it if they want to release it. And if, yeah, it's just a lot of ifs. So it just is really dumb. Yes, Mom.
Do you have any final advice for old folks in terms of connecting with young folks? Like, in Rochester, there aren't a lot of groups that are young and all together, like Enough is Enough, but
right.
Like, there are younger groups and there are older groups, and we haven't really been able to make a lot of coalition building. I'm just wondering how you get to that point where you were talking to Pat about, you know, you say, you know, don't tell us what to do, but we will, you know, would like to know your experience, and then we'll use it the way we want. How did you make those connections with people?
That's a good point. I think you just have to be a good organizer. Like, I think, like, it's good or bad organizing. I think, like, a good, like, if you really are about the work, regardless if you're young or old, like, you'll get out the way to be humble, right? And I think it's that simple. I think that goes for young and old. But elders have a certain, like, power dynamic that they can assert, and so that becomes something different. But if you want to organize and you want to do work, then you'll recognize power and recognize where you can be resourced and used, and then do that thing, right? And so I think some tangible things you can do is teach adultism classes. So adultism is just like sexism, just like racism, is like because you have a certain age or because you have a certain social standing as an adult, you have certain privileges, and that and it's based on the belief that, like, based on your age, like, young people based on their age don't know anything, don't have knowledge, which is totally false, right? Like, you know, I've learned things from 6-year-olds that I never learned when I was in college, right? So, like, that, just talking about, like, if you can teach other people the same way you did, the same way that you do, like, cop watch workshops or know your rights workshops, you can do adultism classes. Teach people why it's messed up to talk to young people in a certain way. Yeah. That's one thing elders in the community can do. And being in meetings, I'll tell you this, COCO, which is the Kenwood Oakland Community Organization, I respect their youth organizer, G2 Brown. G2 Brown is gonna be a legend one day. Like, you'll look back and, like, look at him. He's really dope. And he is the most humble person you'll ever meet in terms of as a youth organizer. And he's, like, in his 50s or 60s now. And he will go into meetings, and this is what I'll advocate for other people to do, he'll go into meetings and advocate for the work that young people are doing. He'll call me on a daily basis. He'll call me and be like, hey, we want to support this action. We want to bring our people out, but we don't want to step on your toes or take credit for it. Like, that's a daily thing that he would do. And the best thing he ever did was Charlene Carruthers from Black Youth Project 100 was going on MSNBC or somewhere to do an interview. And G2 Brown called me and was like, look, I'm not going to take the space of the young people. I have a space on that too. I'm going to give all my time to her. Like, that is what good organizing looks like to me, when you're like, look, I know my power, I know my role, let Charlene have the whole time, I'm not gonna speak, right? Like, that's dope. So, yeah, I think that's where y'all can do stuff. Where, yeah. Yeah. But y'all do awesome stuff, like writing reports and stuff that we don't wanna do. Thank you. keep writing stuff.
That's weird.
We don't
wanna
do that.
That's weird too, yeah. A lot of people.
Any other questions? I think we can go into the meeting. So thank you all for listening to me.
Thank you.
Yeah.
What would be my fate, Lord? Death from an officer who I ran to thinking that help he would offer up. 10 shots to the chest, stretched, now they talking to another black man looking fresh in that coffin, or beating till my ribs crack. Rolled up in the gym mat, blood on my kicks match. Police say I did that, no crime, the kid's black. Case closed, casket shut, but taking organs, filling with newspaper and patch him up. Now tell me if that bullshit is matching up. I know y'all just wanna see a crooked, then back it up.